started.
Welcome to day 20, guys. And today, I'm skipping the recap from yesterday's class because we did not really discuss anything in yesterday, just the React router and how to add the routes and how to go to the route directly and how we can use hash router. And also we talked about a little bit about how deployment versus on a regular router versus a hash router would help, and the URL and URL stuff and all that. Today's class, we will discuss a very important part of React, which is not a necessary part of React. But still, today's job requirements are always like this: experience with React and Redux. You should, a lot of job requirements says this. Redux is like a mandatory, and a lot of people talking about Redux, and all that stuff. Before jumping on what a Redux is, let's see what Redux can bring us into the application. Why do we need Redux? Okay, let me make this point very clear at the beginning of the class. We do not need Redux for developing a React application. Okay, Redux helps to make a better React application or maintain the React application, but it's not a necessary thing. This is an interview question. Do you need Redux to create a React application? For the last 19 days, we were creating, creating a React application. But there was no single point in the class where I said we would need a Redux. We were able to create a very small application, an e-commerce application, without using the Redux. Now let's see, why do we need Redux? But before that, let's see what advantages, why do we need Redux in the first place, and what advantages it does bring in the Redux. The first advantage is that, let's see what is a problem, and let's see how Redux gives a solution to that problem. Okay. Now on my left screen, on my left, you see with Redux, this application is built with Redux, and the right application is built without the Redux. To differentiate a little bit, you can see the tab name in here, which says without Redux, and there is an image of the React in here. There is a logo of Redux in here. So let's just bring in without the Redux. This is a very simple tile application. There's not too much code in here. There is I will go back to the code, but very simple application. Each time I click on a tile, it just bumps up a number. Okay, very simple. And each time, very simple. Each component, each tile have its own state. Whenever I click on that tile, it just increases the state value from 1 to 2 to 3, and it also changes the color. As simple as that. Okay. Now this is a very simple application, and there is a bug in inside this application. Now let's see what is the bug. When user is trying to click on these tiles, and whenever user clicks more than 49 times. Okay, so I'm on 30, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 48, 49. And whenever I click after the 49, the tile just disappears. Okay, imagine a situation where there is some malfunctioning happening on the UI on a real world application where this is happening. Now, the QA team files a ticket and they will write the detailed step-by-step way of reproducing the bug. They are not sure how to reproduce the bug. They would write something like this. They are very sure how to reproduce the bug, but they're not sure what is causing the bug to happen. So it's the developer's job. So they write a detailed description saying that go to this application, localhost 3001 or whichever the domain. Step number one. Step number two, click on a tile 49 times, hold there, and then click one more time, and the tile disappears. This is a bug ticket, okay? Now, as a developer, I get this ticket to my plate, and I start debugging this application. The first thing I have to do is reproduce the bug, right? So when I get a bug, I have to reproduce the bug. If the bug exists or do not exist, I have to make sure. If without reproducing the bug, I don't know how to fix the bug. I have to make sure how do I properly reproduce the bug. So I open up my application. So this is the default state of my application. Now at this point, to reproduce the bug, how many times should I click?
49 times.
49 times, right? Including the first click, like 40, mm-hmm. give and take 49 times I have to click. Now in a bigger application, there are use cases where, you know, sometimes you, for example, you know, you're going on an e-commerce application. It looks like you're clicking, you're adding like 200 products into the cart and you're trying to have 201 product and the bug crashes. Now in your application, you have to click 200 times on your application in order to go to a state where you can reproduce this bug. Now, I have to click this maybe 49 times. And then I make a fix, which I'm not sure will fix the bug or not. Then again, I refresh the application. I apply the fix. Again, how many times I need to fix? Click on that. Again, 49 times I have to click, right? Mm. This is really painful, isn't it? This is really painful. Every time I have to reproduce the bug 49 times, I have to click. But what if I can time travel? Now, this is a very fancy word created by the Redux people. And they say Redux helps you to time travel. You can directly go to 49th step. How do we do that? Let's go back to the application that we done with the Redux. Let's come back in here. Click, 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 click. Go to 49th state. Okay, now we have a 49th state. Right click, inspect. Now there are the same way how we have React tools on the web, we also have Redux tools, the mm-hmm. Redux Chrome plugins. Redux Chrome extensions. Once you install them, you should be able to see this little button, Redux in here. Okay, and what I do in here is I can click on a persist, a simple button in here, persist. Okay, I click on that button and see what happens if I refresh my page. You see, my application is directly jumping to the 49th state, or the 49th number. Do you think this will help the developer? Time saving?
Yes.
A lot, right? So you can able to create a state without actually going through all the steps. And you know what? You don't have to click the 49 times. What you can do is you can ask your testing team to download the state. You see here in it, export. You can simply click on export my temporary file. I would say just state.json, save it. Okay, this is state.json. I would close this. I would not persist my application because I'm really lazy. I really don't want to click 49 times. I clear off the persist. Okay, this is my default state of the application. I give it a right click, inspect, and then Redux. I go to import, and then just import the state that the testing team just downloaded to recreate the state. Create, open, and boom. I should be able to directly go to that 49th state of the application. And what? I can do, this is called time travel. I can directly go to that state of the application. Maybe I added 200 products into the cart. I don't have to click again to add the products into the cart. I can directly go to the adding the 201 product and reproduce the bug. This will save hell out of time for each and every developer. This is the first advantage of Redux.
Okay. What are the applications? It may be if you're on the process, then it will be able to find out the bugs.
Arjun, say that again.
If you're on the process, then it will show you the defects in our application.
I didn't quite get that.
What are the application it is? If you're on the process, will it fetch you the bug?
If you go to other websites?
In general.
If that application uses Redux and you have access to the source code, like I'm running it on my local machine, then you should able to persist your state.
Okay.
This is all development tools. They are not, do not work in the production. Okay. Everything we do it on the client side. We're trying to do the state, whatever with the React is also on, it's always on the client side. When you hit the production, you no longer have React. You no longer have anything. It's all put back into HTML, CSS, JavaScript. And it is a reason. See, people don't want to expose all of these actions and all this. We'll go to part where we actually say actions. Did I answer your question?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, you know what? I can step back as well. So, there's a little slider in here. I want to step back in my application state. I can still able to do that. I can step back. Step forward. This is like playing a movie. I can go back. I can go to the front. I mean, I can go forward. This way, it really helps a lot of time for the developer to reproduce a bug. This is the first advantage. And this is one of the advantages. This is not the main advantage. This is the time travel. The second thing is that, this is a little complex, but try to stay with me. Managing the state. Okay, so let's take a look at the code base of these two applications. I'll try to put, let's close this guy in here. So left is with Redux and right is without Redux. I'll go in here. I open up the code with Redux. So let's first see our application without Redux and see what's inside it. So this is the code for without the Redux. Okay, very simple, plain structure. We got an index where you have a wall as a default component. And inside the wall, if you go, there are tiles. And I'm creating 100 tiles in here. Each tile, and I'm rendering those tiles. And each tile is nothing but a very simple React component like others, but each tile have its own independent state, individual state. So every component, every tile component have its own state, right? And whenever I click on the button that on the tile, basically, I'm just increasing the value of the click count plus one, the current count plus one. So 0, 1, 2, 3, I keep increasing the number as soon as I clicking it. Now, this is without Redux. Every component is managing its own state. Okay, folks, every component is managing its own state. Let's see how the component is managing its own state. So right click, inspect, components, and I click on one of the components, click and go to this component, and you can see the click count. It has a state, and the state has been increased to 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth. So each component state does not have anything to do with the other component state. Every component is independent. Are we clear on that? But coming to Redux, let's see what is happening inside the Redux world. Inspect. Components. Same thing. But you see, let me click on the first one here. And go to the first one. Do you see the component is no longer managing its own state, but it gets the state or the value as a prop. Okay, look at here and here. Without the Redux, every component is managing its own state as I click. But with Redux, right in here, the component is not managing the state. It is getting the data externally by the wall component. Okay? And the wall has the entire state of the application. Are we clear? Okay, now let's go back to see the Redux code. Now guys, if you are just getting started with React, it's little harder to understand Redux at the first glance. Personally, it took me over a month when I first started learning Redux, because I was learning React on the web versus Redux at the same time, because I'm from a mobile background. I did React Native on the mobile. And you know what? Redux can be used on mobile as well. So it's not very confined to just a web technology. It can be used on the web. And you know what? Redux is not just confined to use in React. You can use Redux anywhere where you need to manage the data. Okay. Now let's go back to our application with using Redux and see how the code base is. Okay, so let me put with Redux on the left. And without Redux, you can see the title in here, without the Redux on the right. So I'm always trying to be consistent. With Redux is always on the left, without Redux is on the right. Okay, now let's check the without Redux. It's just the index.file, the tile, and each tile have its own component, own state in here. But take a look at the Redux folder structure. Guys, if you just look at the folder structure, you would able to tell if this application have Redux or not. Okay. The first clue is that in order to use Redux in your application, you need two things. Redux, the package itself, and React Redux. There's another package, because Redux can be used with other various technologies. But if you want to use Redux with React, you need this package called React Redux. Okay, and take a look at the folder structure. Everything is simple. The index, tile, wall, the colors is nothing but the list of colors that I'm throwing in. Everything is same, but there is a little more folders in here. Let's start with a store and see what is inside the store. Now the keyword store is nothing but, if you put the data inside a component, it's called a state, right folks? But if you snatch the state, if you take away the state and put it in the Redux world, that becomes a store. Let me give you a very simple example, folks. Imagine a family of five people, and let's say five people are five different React components. Each person have a different bank account, okay? And that each person puts the money into their personal bank account and takes the money out of their personal bank account, okay? This is the five different banks, five people putting money and taking out. If there is a family emergency, okay, if there is a family emergency, to understand the financial situation of the family, I have to go to the each person, get their account, the amount of money in their account, gather the information, come back, total up everything, then I would know the financial situation of that company, right? If there is a family emergency. Now this is little as the number of people in the family grows from 5 to 10 to 15 to 20 to 25. Now 25 people having for 25 different bank accounts, and I start collecting the amount of each person. If I collect the first person and I go to the 25th person, by the time the first person might have done some transactions and the bank account, the balance might be differing from the point where I collected to where I'm summing it up. So I have an inconsistent data. But what if that these 25 people try to manage one simple bank and put the money into that bank and take the money out of that bank? Would it be easy in this case to understand the financial situation? And I would always have up-to-date balance, account balance of the entire family. Now put the same analogy into UI, you have maybe hundreds and hundreds of components. Each component managing its own state. Each component is managing its own state. State is nothing but a bank having their money, which is the data inside the component. Okay, so each person is each component is managing their own state. If there is a crisis, or you know, if there is a bug inside the component, I have to understand the state of each and every component and try to reproduce the state of each and every component. But instead, if I have a state at one simple at one particular location called store, which is a central bank, now every component will get the data from that store, put the data into that store. Okay. That means, is it clear how Redux helps to snatch away the state from individual components and put it in one centralized location? So at any point of time, you always have one source of truth. The components do not no longer have their individual state. Yeah, Arjun, what's the question again?
Yeah, I have a quick question, Vikram, here. Why isn't, so after listening to the Redux, it has a lot of advantages. So why isn't made it as a mandatory for the React, along with the React?
Excellent, good question. So you're asking if React is, the Redux is helping React so much, right? Why doesn't people integrate React Redux into the application? If you go to React official, Redux official website, let's see, Redux is not needed. There used to be a page which clearly says you don't need Redux. The reason is that, Arjun, if your application is so small, okay, it's just in adding the items, reviewing the items in the application we build, it's so small application that adding Redux would add, take a look at this, guys, here. So this is the left is without Redux, the left is with Redux and the right is without Redux. Already my application just need 4 files in here. Okay, and take a look at the left. I have a 3 extra folders and each folder have a different file in them. If your application is very simple, straightforward, where you can easily guess what is the issue, you really don't need Redux because you're adding extra load. Okay, and unnecessarily complicating your application. If your application is, this is an interview question, guys. When do you use Redux? Do you really need Redux? I would answer something like this. If my business application, if the business use case is simple, straightforward, and my application does not have a lot of state, okay, in my application, I'm trying to put a lot of state while putting in a lot of tiles and I'm putting in a lot of hundreds of tiles in here. I'm just simulating in a scenario where this is a really huge application. But if you have a very simple application, so I would answer something like this. If my application state is simple, okay, and has a lot of straightforward cases, I would not really add Redux into this application, which would unnecessarily complicate and increase the code base. But if my application is growing and there is a lot of state that I need to add, if it reaches to a point where I feel like managing the state is harder, then I would start integrating Redux into this application. Because the larger your state, the more there is a lot of flow involved in your application. Okay, if it's a very simple portfolio website where user is scrolling and just looking at the information, I don't need Redux in there because there is no state change. I'm just looking at the information you know, scrolling through it. I really don't need an Redux in there. I'm unnecessarily adding more code into my database. And guys, I keep telling Redux makes life easier, but to reach to this point, Redux, there are other state management tools. Okay. The very early state management tool was called Flux. It is from open source by the Facebook. Now what Redux and the difference between the Flux is that if you take a look at in here, this is again a very good interview question. A lot of interviewers would try to put you in this. What is the difference between a Flux and a Redux? Okay. The first difference is that Flux can have multiple stores. A Flux application can have more than one store. Okay. But Redux only has one store. The first difference. Flux has multiple stores. Redux has only one store. So for example, if your application, like let's say your Amazon, okay, you can separate your stores. For example, you can say payment is another store. Login is another store. Adding items to a cart is another store. Browsing deals is another store. So you can separate the stores. But what if you need to communicate from one store to another store? For example, you're adding an item from the deals, which goes into the cart. So you need to send the data from the cart store to the payment store. So this started adding more complication into the application. So Redux came and said, we no longer having many stores. You would only have one simple store. And inside the store, you would have a lot of reducers. A reducer is nothing but a very small piece of state that belongs to one particular use case. So you can have a payment reducer, you can have a check-in reducer, you can have a cart reducer. Instead of having different stores, you would have different reducers. This is the first difference. Flux have multiple stores, Redux have single store. The second difference, guys, remember I told you something about copy by value by copy by reference?
Uh-huh.
You created object called employee, and then I extended that object and changed the gender of the employee, but it was also changing the gender of the first object.
Right, I remember.
Yeah, then we started doing json.parse and json.stringify and doing a deep copy of the object.
Right.
Flux mutates the store. Flux mutates the store. When I say Flux mutate the store, it will create a variable. Okay, so let's say I have an old state, var old state, or I would say not an old state, previous state. This is my previous state, and the name is equal to, I would say color at least, color is equal to red. And what a Flux does is, it does something like this. Var next state is equal to, it would just the previous state, and then it will change the value of previous state dot color is equal to orange. Now, if I go back and see the previous state, my previous state would also console log orange in here because I'm not copying it by the value, I'm copying it by the reference. Now, this was started giving a lot of problems in the UI because you're trying to change a piece of data. And then you copy the data and try to change the properties of the data, and you still have reference to the old data. Now the Flux started creating all these problems, but Redux does something very interesting. It does not copy the old state. It will break the references. So it does something like this. JSON.pass. You get the idea. JSON.stringify. Now my old state, my previous state do not have any references. The next state and my previous state, there is no linkage between the objects. It's completely broken. So the second difference is that Flux mutate the state. Redux recreates the state based on the old states. This is my new state. Okay, it's just the old. This is gonna be new state dot color here. This is my old state. This is a little confusing, guys. But if you start working on the application and once you start seeing this crazy bugs, and then you would really appreciate what flux and redux is. I'm coming from a background where there was no flux, there was no redux, there was only state, and each component have a different state. Your application grows and you fall into a different kind of issues. I have to click like 40, 50 times to go to that state. And a simple refresh would kill my state, and to refresh again. Now, Flux did not have any of those magic tools where I can time travel and all that stuff. Now, Redux brings me two advantages. One, time travel. Second, it does not have any references to the old state. So at any point of time, I can go to my previous state and the next state. And that is what we are looking at, the time travel. Okay, and this is the second the major difference. The first difference is that Flux have multiple stores, Redux have single store. The second difference is Flux mutates the state, Redux recreates the state. Okay, and another interview question would be, what are the advantages of Redux? We already talked about advantages. The first advantage is time travel. And the second advantage is that easy debugging. You can debug your application really easy because you can go to that particular state, see the how the state looks like. In my case, let's see the state. Go to with Redux. And try to go to that particular state directly. Go to Redux, import, go to the state. I will go directly to that state and let's see what is happening to my state as soon as I click in here. So this is my current state in here. And you can actually see my 18th tile have 49, and let's see what happens to that 18th tile when I click on the next. Okay, so it says 15 here. Does my style still exist? Okay, it looks like my style is still intact, but my functionality is good, but there's something wrong with the view. The data is good, but there's something wrong with the view. So let's go and see what's wrong with the view. Go to with Redux and wall. So I know this is something to do with the tile because the wall was intact. And what I can do in here is this is where it's gonna get the background color, and it looks like it's failing in here. And let's see what the background color of this guy. Okay, so copy this guy and console.log and just copy that color in there. And refresh, that should kill my state, but I would import the state again. I'll go to that particular state directly. Okay, and go to my console message, and you can see it's going through the state, and I will click on other one more time. Oh, see that? It looks like when I go to the 58th click, the color is undefined. So my tile is intact in here, but it's not just visible. Okay, so look at this. The background color is good on other tiles, but the background color is not good on this tile. So I could go ahead, add a background color. So there's something to do with my view and the color. And if I go back and see, my colors.json only has 50 items in here. It doesn't have 51 items because 0 to 14 would count to 50. So this is how I can easily debug my application. Now, this is a very simple application and my debugging took less than 5 minutes, but in a complex applications, you would able to get to that state and start debugging really easy. This is a major advantage of Redux. And the third question would be, what are the disadvantages of Redux? It's a very rare question, but be prepared. The disadvantages of Redux is that there is lot more code, the first thing, and there is lot of redundant code. You have to write the same code again and again and again. In this case, you can see a switch case in here. This switch case can go to maybe 50 or 60 cases. Depends on how complex is your application. And you rewrite the same thing again, again, and again, and again, and again, but only with a change of your next state. So you would only change one value inside your state, and you rewrite the code. So this is more verbose. You have to write more code. That is the only case disadvantage with Redux. Okay, so we talked about Flux, we talked about Redux, and there is another state management tool which is really getting popular these days. It's called Mobex. You start seeing this in the next year, maybe in the second quarter of next year. It's quite famous. People started using it. The difference between Redux and the Mobex is that whenever a state is changed on the Redux, because your store is the entire React application. Your store is a React entire application state. So whenever your state changes, all the components render. No matter what, all the components render. You have to go to each component.tile and put in a pure component versus a should component and all that stuff. But with Redux, you can only listen to one part of the store. For example, you have a checkout component, you have a cart component, so two components, right? In Flux world, you would have two stores, checkout store and cart store, okay? But in Redux world, you would only have one store. If that one store changes, your checkout component will change, your payment, your cart component will change, right? But this is not good. If something is happening on the cart, checkout component should not render. So you have to add an extra code in there to understand should component update and throw in the business logic. But in Mobex, you can only listen to one particular piece of store. For example, your checkout component will only listen to checkout piece of store, and your cart component will listen to cart piece of your store. So you're dividing your store into multiple pieces again. We are going back into Flux, but little more advanced. There are no longer multiple stores. Inside the store, you would have multiple reduces. This is the third state management tool in React. There is a less known, very less known. I mean, like, it's from the Microsoft people, but it's a very less known state management tool called Resub. Very less known, only 581 stars, so you can understand how least it is. So this is a very if you're trying to answer this question, if they start asking about Redux, also give a little more detail about how we started doing with Redux, how we started with Flux, how we then moved on to Redux and also Mobex, and also talk a little more about how there's another library called Resub. This is all about managing, and it's called a state management tool or a state management library. Any questions on this? Thank you for asking those questions. Amazing. Now let's jump on to writing a little bit unit testing. Now, guys, unit testing terminologies are very much confusing. You know, when I first started doing unit, I really did not understand why do you have need a unit test? I mean, like, it literally writing the code again, you have to, and to a point where I have reached that coding is easy, but unit testing is hard. You know, sometimes coding the actual functionality is very easy. It's a very straightforward. But trying to unit test that, it's a very painful. You know, you have to be, try to mock stuff and all that stuff. You might spend a day actually coding the functionality, another 2 days just writing the test cases. And I first could not able to understand why do we need unit testing. I mean, like, guys, I know what my component is. I really don't care. I really don't understand or don't care writing the unit test. My component still works and functional. I don't understand writing a unit test. Then, like, after first 1 year of my career, and I was put into a very huge application, and I started, I have no idea about this application. And when I started digging through it, guys, trust me, unit testing were so helpful in understanding the application, because application, one part of the documentation is your the prop types. Other part of the application, other part of the documentation is a unit test. You know, let's try to understand unit test from the ground up. On my screen, you should be able to see a very simple function, very simple JavaScript function that says function add a comma b, and it would just return a plus b. Very simple, very simple, straightforward, simple function. I write this function. I'm trying to create a calculator application, maybe a very huge code base, and I'm just adding a little functionality into that calculator, which is add a function. So this function takes two arguments, a comma b, or the argument could be anything, which is one or two, and would return the sum as one comma one plus two, which is three. Okay, very simple test. Let's try to do this. I would say console.log, I would add 1, 3, okay, which should get me 4. Very straightforward, right? So what happened was that this was very good. My application was in production and everything was good. And for some reason, I have to go to another project. Some guy came into the project, okay, and he thought he's a junior guy. He thought, you know what? I want to make this application, this function a little fancy. I want to rewrite this function. So what he does is he'll try to do this instead of a comma b, because he thinks a comma b does not make sense to me. So I would rename the function to left value and right value, and left value is equal to a comma right value is equal to right value. Right value, and he thought maybe returning is not good. I should assign a variable to it where sum is equal to left value is equal to right value, and he started adding this code. Okay, he wrote this piece of code, and then he moved on to a different project. Then the third person came. And he started looking at this project and said, hey, look what happened. This is sum is equal to left value and right value. And he started putting in more code base. Okay, so he would say something like this. What if the user enters, instead of numbers, what if the user enters a string value? For example, if the user enters something like this. Okay, in my case, it would simply return Vikram, which is fine, but my application is a calculator. It's not a addition of strings, right? But how does he know that my application only accepts numbers? It does not accept strings. Now I have to document this piece of information somewhere. Now I cannot write it in the prop types. I cannot simply add the comments in here because this function, I can add the comments in here, this function, but down the line, some guy will update the function, but we'll never update the comments. And that is all of us, most of us. We'll never take a look at what the comment does, because the comments does not compile. Nobody cares about commenting and all that stuff. Everything is happy, everything is good. But you put onto the production and people start typing numbers and looks fine, and somebody puts in a string. Now, the return of add value not only depends on this function, but you have something like this. 1 minus 1 plus add this one. And this should throw an error or it should do something. But in my case, it would do something very fancy. I'm just writing a pseudo code in here, which makes no sense to somebody who is using a calculator. And this is really gets out of hands real quick. Right, folks? So you need to stop this at some point of time. You need to hold the developer trying, because the developer needs to understand every single use case. So where do we document this? And also that the developer should know, if he tries to add more code, he should not break the existing functionality. He should not break the existing functionality. The primary functionality was adding the numbers. Now I added another functionality, adding the characters in here, which is not valid in a calculator, but he should know the primary functionality. So what I would do in here is I would write a test for this function. So what I would do in here is console.log. I'll comment this code out. Okay, I would write a simple console statement saying console should add numbers. Okay, and I write another console saying add function if add 1, 3 should always return 4. Okay, this is one test. Should add positive numbers. And I write another test, should add negative numbers. Arjun, what would be the value in here?
-4.
Right? So I would add another test, should not add strings, inputs. So should be not equal to. Okay. So the next guy who comes to look at this function, he will try to look at the test cases. Oh, looks like this function should only should have a functionality to add the positive numbers, should able to add the negative numbers, and should not add the strings. Okay, and these are three units. Okay, let me give it a run. Okay, so take a look at this. My first test case is pass because it's been true, because I'm expecting a value which is equal to 4. My test case is passed. The second test case is also true, but look what happens to my third test case. Should not add the string inputs. It looks like it's adding it because it's false, because I'm supposed, it should not be equal to it, right? So what I do is I go change to number. So I changing a value to number. I change whatever the user have given that input to number. And run. And return sum here. And now my test cases are passing. Right. Tomorrow somebody comes and try to do some magic to my code. I say, instead of doing the guy decides that, okay, I don't care if it's a number or a string, and he removes the number. Okay, and give it a run. And immediately my test case would start catching it up. Okay. This way I can able to write a unit test and make sure my primary functionality is intact, but on top of that, I need to add more test cases. Guys, this is where it gets interesting. I have written a few unit tests in here, and each unit test starts with something called it. Okay, this is Jasmine-like syntax. It starts with it. You, each unit test starts with it. And it should return 4 in this case. And I take in a function. And I should expect the value of add, which takes 1, 3 to equal to 4. And this is a very simple Jasmine-like syntax. This is a unit test. And this is called assertion. And you can have any number of assertions. You're expecting a value to equal to something else. And there is a library for this assertion. You can use a default library, or you can use an assertion library called Chai. You might have heard this in a lot of job requirements. Chai assertion library helps you to expect the values and compare them to another value and would say if your test is passing or failing. Now this is in terms of JavaScript, but we are here for testing our React components, right folks? We are here for testing our React components. And in order to test the React components, you would need a test renderer, okay? A test renderer. Guys, this is gonna go out of hands real quick, but stay with me. If you have a component in the React world, in order to render the component, you would need a browser. Do you agree with me or not? Right?
Yeah. Right.
You need a component to be rendered. You need a browser. Right, folks? What a test renderer or a mock renderer, these libraries do that. They take a React component, they produce, they give you a copy of a component which is equivalent of what it looks like on a browser. Okay, now let me show you the code. Let's take a look at the test, one of the test file. Okay, so in this scenario, you would have a lot of other testing libraries. One of the testing libraries is Jest. Jest is by the Facebook. You can use Jest or you can use Enzyme. Or you can use the latest React test utils. You have 3 different options. Either you can use a Jest. Now what a Jest does is, it takes your React component and gives out a component which is equivalent of how it's rendered on a browser. The same thing you can also do with Enzyme. Enzyme does the same thing. And there is a recently getting really popular, it's called React Testing Library. You can use either of these 3 libraries to mock, to create, or to simulate a component which is equivalent of producing it on a browser. What do you do with that component? Let's take a look. So in my case, I'm just writing one simple test case in here. If you guys remember, my product component takes 4 parameters: name, phrase, price, ID, and an image. What I'm trying to do in here is to get Now, Enzyme has a different ways of mounting the component. One is shallow mount and a render. There's a differences between all the three. Depending on the use case, you would do this. But I'm just using a shallow render. A shallow render would take the component and use me a wrapper or a mock product. And what I do is, I use expect mock product dot find, which is my product component. Go to the product. So this gives me a render function in here. I'm trying to see if the product component has an ID called product to be false. In this case, does it exist? Is there an ID in here? No, right? There's no ID in here. So this test case will pass. And how do I run the test case? Just give me a minute.
Yeah.
Okay. So I have written, this is going to be not a test code. This is going to be a product. Product component. Okay. Different projects have setting up their test in a different way. I'm using it just a very standard way. I created a folder called test, and under the folder, I created a product.test.js. Few people do that product-test.js, but I would prefer this way because it really helps me to, when I start searching something, if I have to search something across the projects, I can filter out the so I can only include test.js, and this really helps me to really quickly look through the file. So I would prefer doing it .test.js instead of -.js. This is a very simple React component product. I'll try to put the product component right next so you can see the test as well as the component. Okay, and remember this. The terminology for writing test for the entire component is called suite, or if people say a spec, depends on the terminology that is being used across the inside the project. There is a describe, which is which component that I'm trying to test. Then I have a bunch of variables, which are like a fake product name, fake product price, fake product ID, because I'm trying to mock, recreate the product, but not in a browser, but using a regular test renderer, which is gonna be React or, Enzyme or Jest or React Test Utils. In this case, I'm just using Enzyme, and I'm passing in the product to that shallow utility that I'm getting it from Enzyme. And what it does is it gives me a mock product. Now this mock product is the actual component that has been rendered. Okay, replacing all the values of the properties with the fake data, which is this guy. So what I do is, the first test case would be, is the component is rendering my name? This is a useless test case that I've written. I'm just checking to see if there is a product ID to here, which is not in my case. This test probably might have crept in where they used to have an ID, and then the ID might have removed, and the unit test still make sure that the ID is no longer added in the future. Okay. Now then I have another test case. It just renders and says that the mock product render it, and I'm checking if the component go find a class name called product.name. Now this name should be replaced by whatever name I pass into this component to equal to the product name. So the product name is some name. So it should, the name should be replaced with some name. And the second thing is, should render the product price with rupees as prefix if passed. So I'm passing a price name in here, which is going to be, what is the price? 200. And what I see is on my UI, if I pass this property on my UI, it should say rupees and the amount. okay, the fake product price, and it is rendering. Should render the product price as zero with rupees as prefix if not passed. Remember, we have a component default property. If the price is not passed, your default price is zero. So I'm testing that as well. I'm testing if the component, if the price is not passed, because in here I'm passing the price. In here I'm not passing the price, but still the component should render rupees zero. This is another test. And the component should render the image. If I'm passing an image, it should render the same image. So you can see props.source of that image. So that should render my product. That should render the image. And should render the ad. Always take a look at it. Consider reading like this. It should render the add button. If the product is not in the cart, if the product is not in the cart, it should have a button called add. Right, it should have a button which is button dot hyphen hyphen add exists. This should be true, and the button should have a label of add. And if the item is already in the cart, it should have a remove button. So I'm trying to reproduce every use case of the product component, passing in different properties and seeing how the component behaves. And then what I do in here, and you can see if the component renders with ID and cart status, if clicked on the add button. If the item is clicked on the add button, I'm making sure that the item is added into the cart. So if it isn't true, I'm just adding it. I think this is the same test case that I'm using in here. So I can totally skip this. And how do I run the test cases? I just go to terminal. npm run test, and that should run my all my test cases and also give me how many tests that I'm how many test cases I'm writing. 8 test cases in this here, and I have 2 test cases in app.js, but 2 in here, because this guy is another test case and this guy is another test case. Then I go back to, this is another assertion. This is another assertion. I go back to product.test. I have eight test cases in here. It took me 2.435 seconds. And there are a bunch of ways I can start doing running the test cases. In this example, let's just run all the test cases. I can hit the hey button. That would run all the test cases again. And let's see what is called a test-driven development. What I would do in here is I would go into my product and I'll try to change something in my product. Okay, I'm a developer who just came into the project and I'm trying to change something on the project. So I thought there is unnecessarily I need this product price is equal to zero. So I comment this guy out and a save button. And immediately you should see one of my test cases failing. It should render the product right in here. It's saying that should render the product price as zero with rupees as prefix, it not passed. So if I'm a developer, I think that, okay, there is a use case inside the project where they need a price is equal to zero. So I put back this and my test case passes. This is called test-driven development, and I can the test-driven development also means that you write your test cases first. You write your test cases first, and then you start writing your component. So every time you change something on your component, your test cases should all pass. And anytime you add a new functionality into the component, you should write the equivalent test case. So make sure your existing functionality is not broken, because it's literally very hard to test each and every corner case. Right, folks, I cannot go run the UI, go check, oh, is it zero? Okay, it's not passing in. I cannot reproduce every single thing. So what I do, I automate all the unit test cases. So each unit test will put the product into a different state, into a different variation. And I make sure every variation passes before I add the new functionality. Okay, folks. For example, somebody thought, you know, if let's go by in here. I have this product, and inside the product, I have a button called view. Let's go to render button. And the render button says, if the item is in the cart, I would say remove. If the item is not in the cart, I would say add. Can you guys think of any fancy name other than remove?
Delete.
Yeah, delete, right? So tomorrow, you know, the UI UX person says, guys, you know, people are getting confused about removing it. Does it mean remove from the UI or remove from the cart? So we want to come up with a better naming thing. We call it delete. Now this ticket is called, okay, rename the delete remove button to delete button. And I just replace that with the delete button. I give it a save. Now one of my test case would fail, right? Because my test case was expecting remove, but it found delete. So what I do in here, I not only add the code, I not only change the functionality, but I also go back and update my test case. Now my test case should not start looking at delete. It should start looking at, remove. Start looking at delete. So I go back in here, which is remove, and I say delete. And that should bring back. So every time you make a change onto your component or the code, you also make change into your test. So you are testing your change. Cool, folks?
Yeah.
Any questions?